I kept saying, I'm a member of that.
It was very helpful.
It was fun. It was a proof.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Jonathan Abarbanel, and I'm chairperson of the American Theater Critics Association. It's my pleasure to welcome you to Perspectives in Criticism, a public talk presented as part of the annual conference of the American Theater Critics Association and its companion charitable foundation. Over many years, we've had some of the nation's most eloquent and passionate theater critics speak to us about many aspects of theater and our profession. But we've never before asked a playwright to deliver her perspectives on what we do. So today is a first as we invite Lauren Gunderson to sound off on the relationship between playwrights and critics. It's singularly appropriate that we do this not only as a part of the Critics Conference, but as part of a great national celebration of authorship, the Humana Festival at the Actors Theater of Louisville. Born in Atlanta, Georgia, and raised in the South, Lauren Gunderson quickly has established herself as a prolific and accomplished dramatist and screenwriter, though I suspect it was not as quick as she might have liked. Her work has been produced from coast to coast and back again, quite literally. Her play, I and You, is a finalist for the 2014 Steinberg American Theater Critics Association New Play Award, and also was named a finalist for the 2014 Susan Smith Blackburn Prize. It was an NNPN, that's National New Play Network, an NNPN rolling world premiere last year, and will roll to three more cities this year. In 2011, her comedy Exit, Pursued by a Bear, also was a rolling world premiere, and now has been staged in more than 20 US cities. Her very newest play, Bauer, recently completed its world premiere at the San Francisco Playhouse, which commissioned it, and it will be staged this summer in New York City at the 59 East 59th Theaters. But it's not only Ms. Gunderson's success as a playwright which brought her to our attention. She writes in a variety of media on a variety of topics, as befits someone who also holds a seat as a Reynolds Fellow in Social Entrepreneurship at New York University. And she could probably give a whole talk on that alone. Among Ms. Gunderson's topics has been commentary on theater criticism and critics, especially as posted on her own Tumblr site and in several interesting interviews she's granted. It's the intelligence of her own critical writing and commentary which caught our attention and convinced us she was the right person to represent the voice of the playwright. It is my honor to present Lauren Gunderson.
Hi. Hi, my name is Lauren Gunderson. I am a playwright. You are a room full of critics, and this is not going to be awkward at all. We're all gonna be just fine. We're gonna make it through great. I do not speak for all playwrights, of course, as we are like dogs in many and varied species. But I do understand, as Jonathan mentioned, that I'm the first playwright who's had the honor of speaking to you, and it is quite an honor. It's also an addiction, as I'm sure if you're like me and could manage to talk about theater all day, if somebody would pay you or let you or both, or neither, because we're going to do it anyway. So we meet today as a support group for those compelled to find each other in the dark, turn off their mobile devices, and watch people live in front of us for hours. We are an odd bunch, but here we are. Fact: in pre-revolutionary France, actors and executioners weren't allowed to be full citizens because of their morally questionable professions. I don't know where playwrights and critics fit on that morality scale, but I'm sure wherever it is, we're right next to each other. So once again, here we are, together, hoping that the next show we write or the next show we review just knocks our socks off. Here we are together, thrilled at the leap of an athletic actor into a role we've never encountered before. Here we are together, going to the theater, caring about the theater, believing that the theater can do good work in the world, knowing that this ancient practice belongs in the present. Here we are being full theater idealists in the way that Todd London showed us we could be in his last book, The Ideal Theater. Indeed, we are together in this craft and in this art. That's why it's not awkward. We are all together in the vitality and accessibility and coherence of the American theater. We are not just practitioners. We are not just individuals. We are collective advocates. This is our ecology. Because we all love theater. We all want it to be its best. We all have high standards and work our asses off and don't get paid enough and have enough time. And sometimes we have to make imperfect compromises, and we all know it when we do, but we get up, not at the crack of dawn, because we're theater people, but we do get up. And when we do, we support, make people talk about art. And most of us, I hope all of us, cannot wait to see what someone comes up with next to shake us out of our patterns or surprise us or move us. So, what can I tell you about criticism that you don't already know, at which you aren't already professionals, that I would have any right or knowledge to explain to this esteemed body? I'm still not exactly sure, but I'm still honored to have a stage, and I'm also still talking. So we're just gonna go for it and be honest and fluid and generous of heart. And last week I read a ton about theater criticism, so I am super qualified now. I can tell you how to make a play. It takes a damn long time usually. And when you get to the end and write blackout on the first draft, which could take untold numbers of days and months and tantrums, that's actually when the real work starts. Readings, rewrites. Pitches, rewrites. Workshops, rewrites. Take a shower, have a life, no time, rewrites. Or committed procrastination, either way, it's very taxing. So the pattern that I recognize after doing this for a decade or so is that I usually get to draft 16 before the play is done-ish. Draft 14 is usually the draft that goes into first production, if I'm so lucky to have one. You will note the number differential between first production and done-ish. After the first production, I continue to rewrite, to take in all that we learned. Audiences, of course, tell us so much. So do trusted friends and dramaturgically minded confidants. So does my mother, who always have two notes that make all the difference, always two. All of this teaches and inspires and reminds and propels much more than we can actually apply or force our capable actors to apply by the time our few previews are over in the regional theater and we open and y'all come in. This is also where the speech could get awkward again, but we won't let it. Honesty and fluidity and generosity of heart. Here we go. This is where I can tell you what it's like to read reviews of your brand new play while it is currently in production, just starting out, hoping your artistic intentions were seen and manifested and understood. It's a roller coaster ride every time. Good reviews are, surprisingly, amazing. Good reviews feel like a relief, like there's hope for more plays in the future, like maybe they'll invite me back, like maybe theater is not the most insane profession of all the liberal arts, like maybe this play will go beyond this production. Maybe it'll see other cities, other iterations. Maybe it will last, maybe it will grow, maybe this play will actually get the chance to find its audience, which is the real point, isn't it? Not praise or more commissions or pull quotes, although those are lovely. Audience, theater doesn't really work without it, and we want them coming back, we want them engaged. So any review that encourages audiences to see the play for themselves is a good review to me. That's a healthy American theater. Hey everyone, go see plays. No really, go see more plays. Even if the review says I hated it, like completely hated it because of this and this, but you should check it out anyway because of this and this, that's totally fine. I will take that. I didn't like it is different from it's not worth seeing. I'd actually love much more of that than I ever read. So I can tell you that more than being disliked, playwrights fear being misunderstood. That's the worst. That's when it feels like the review for your play is not the play you wrote, and no one really learns from that. I can tell you that reviews of new plays are powerful forces in that play's future. I can tell you that people outside of our towns read reviews to decide whether or not they're even going to read the play. Not everyone does this, of course, but a lot of people do. It's sad and unproductive and does not trust the new play process very much. I can tell you that new plays need to grow, and to mature. And that usually takes at least one full production, plus some distance, plus another rehearsal process for the second production before it's done-ish. I can tell you that sometimes new plays die too early because of poor critical reception. We all know this happens. I hate it. I'm sure many of you do too. I can also tell you that I'm not going to accept that there is an inherent antagonism between critics and theater makers, because we're all theater makers. We're all audience builders and art advocates and theater champions. Of course we are. But this is, of course, where it gets tricky. Our relationship is complicated, and as much as I have the right to build a play as I see fit, y'all have the right and duty to convey your opinion of it. And sometimes that opinion is painfully powerful and stunts a new play before it starts. This might have been the case for the very play that you are so generously honoring as a Steinberg nominee, my play, I and You. For its first production at the wonderful theater company, Marin Theater, last year, we were reworking up until opening, as we often are. We got really close to that artistic intention. But there was, of course, room for growth. As I've mentioned before, there always is. There's always things you learn from that last preview that you wish you could just push pause, go back into rehearsal for a week, rewrite the whole scene, but alas, we open tomorrow. The audience taught us a ton, including that this play draws young people. The best compliment the show got, as far as I'm concerned, was when teenagers who came to see the school matinee with their high schools returned with their parents to see the play again. Teenagers brought their parents to the theater. Our salvation has come. We are safe. Amen. But two major papers reviewed it and thought that it was annoying and boring. Our terrible and brief appraisal of art in the Bay, our version of those stars, is called The Jumping Man. And we can have another whole discussion about the aggravating insouciance of stars and jumping men and all of those thumbs up and thumbs down that I don't think really helps our endeavor very much. But that was the last time I'm going to make that quip. Our version of stars, as I mentioned, is that jumping man whose excitement and position in his chair tells you how good the play is. He was not a happy little jumping man. The little man was not jumping. He was sitting still. He was not even clapping. That is very bad. Even though we got glowing reviews from so many other paid papers and theater blogs in town, this was still very bad. Ticket sales weren't great because of that, because there's an algorithm that for every decrease in position of that stupid little jumping man, their revenue shrinks by tens of thousands of dollars. The show is not getting an audience, even though I got emails saying, thank God I didn't listen and brought my granddaughter anyway. So that could have been the end of that play, with those prominent reviews, it could have suddenly shrunk and sunk to the bottom of everyone's to-read pile, if it had not been a part of a national new play network rolling world premiere. So before we opened at Marin Theaters, I'm sure you guys are already much aware of this program, we had three more productions lined up before we even started rehearsals for the first one. So there was a built-in safety net for me and the interested parties to continue the work on the play in our own way, to implement the larger discoveries we saw during that run, which were large, to let the production teach us, not define us. After rewrites, we have a new cast, design, director, and a whole new city continued the premiere of I Knew at Olney Theater, where it's gotten some of the best reviews of my life, and became a Susan Smith Blacker nominee and a nominee for your prestigious award. So what do we make of this? Well, I carefully and with great hesitation wrote a blog post called On Rolling World Premieres and Only Reading Good Reviews, which I think is in part why I'm here today. So, yes, I learned a long time ago that when you're going to glance at a review as a playwright of your own work, only read the good ones. It's not denialist, it's certainly not trying to be. It's just trying to be self-protective. So I have my husband scan them and tell me which ones seemed fair, which ones seemed to have understood which what we were going for. I should have put this duty in our vows. It is very important. Now, of course, the good reviews don't need to be raves. That's not what I'm looking for either. But it needs to be someone who seems to be a believer in the play, like I am. A person who thinks it's worth their time, like I do. That's a person I can have a conversation with. Because neither plays nor reviews are actual conversations. They are catalysts of conversations, but they are not dialogue, unless we make them. We are offering things to each other kind of in the dark, throwing halves of conversations over a fence and hoping someone catches it. But that's not actually talking or conversing. So, conversational criticism, let's put that on our bullet point list. Let's invent it. It'll take more time and it'll take some extra bravery on everyone's account, but I think we can do it. I don't even know what it means, but I think we should try. especially if it means that theater is presented in an ever fuller and more authentically complex way around discussion of intention and not just judgment. I think that will serve us all. Side note on this front, I'm loving the projects by Mark Blankenship at TDF Stages, which is his online theater magazine, which includes video profiles of theaters across the country. It's shareable, it's communal, it's brief, conversational, celebratory, and it's a platform for the artist to declare that important artistic intent. I really like that. That may be a start. So as I mentioned, I did not read the bad reviews of INU. I could tell by their titles and the fact that no one was posting them anywhere on my Facebook that they were less than supportive. And they may have been snarky or kindly and gently dismissive, but either way, I don't know. I only say this, that I didn't read it, to explain that whatever was in those reviews, whatever bad things they said, did not prompt rewrites. It was the natural process of playwriting that prompted those rewrites. They may have said the exact same thing that I actually ended up doing, but that's how theater actually goes. The natural lessons you learn in a production, the organic flow of the play's growth. So it took two productions. For me, it always does. Literally always. Even when the play gets raves on its first outing, I still go through the same natural plot process and rewrite before anyone is allowed to touch it again. So does this mean that the play wasn't ready for a production in its first outing? Or that plays need ever more development? No, it means that productions are development. I said it before, I will say it again, rolling world premieres save lives. So this isn't a new idea in American theater, of course, that plays need to learn and grow through production, not just through readings and workshops. Not all plays need it, but most plays do. Every playwright I asked said that it takes at least two full productions to get it to that done-ish state. Even the ones who already got raves, like my mentor Robert Schenken, whose wonderful play All the Way is on Broadway right now and got your incredible award last year. He continued to work on the play while they were rehearsing at the Neil Simon Fences. August Wilson's amazing play got totally slammed in its initial production and eventually, of course, became a firmament in our American canon. So over and over again, this happens. Those are the plays that actually made it out of that process. But how many of them didn't? The playwright wasn't big enough or didn't have another committed production to continue to make it more perfect. We lost those plays. They're gone. Now, I'm not saying be nice to new plays always. Okay, maybe I am. Be nice to new plays. They are hard as hell to write, and they take a lot of time, and it is always the play itself that usually suffers more of the bad review than anyone else involved. So, okay, wait, no. I don't know how to do your job any more than you know how to do mine. So that's not what I exactly mean. I don't know what the answer is. I just know that awareness of the new play ecology that we are all in is part of it. And maybe we don't change anything and we keep it simple and we all just do what we're already doing. Playwrights write the plays, reviewers come see them. Sure, we can keep it that way, that's fine. Or we might think of what else serves all of us the most. And that is the health and vibrancy of theater as a cultural force in America. Can we iterate on that with respect to playwright criticism relations? Can we invent conversational criticism? Can we say, screw the old format, let's find something else, let's let others in, let's admit that there is more to theater than just tell me what you think. What can we do, producers, playwrights, critics, reviewers, everyone, to help American theater besides what we're already doing? I'll tell you what hurts theater, bad press and bad plays. Once again, it seems that we are in this ecology together. So why don't I follow the advice of if you believe the good ones, you have to believe the bad reviews? Because an opinion is not a universal fact. Because art and reactions to it are fickle, because my job means that I have to have my taste and my aesthetic forefront, or else I can't do what I do, just like y'all. Because it doesn't feel good, all right? Because it makes me angry that some potential audiences will be turned away before they get a chance for the play to speak its own language to them. Because we worked, usually, as I mentioned, damn hard on it. Because there's a point to that story, because bad reviews don't often help writers write, at least this writer. But we're still friends. So why don't bad reviews help me write? The same reason novice theater goers who are just trying to figure out what theater is might not be helped by bad reviews either, because we don't know you. Some reviewers I do know, and I do trust them. They have made connections in my play that I didn't even see, and that is amazing when it happens. But many of you, I just don't have that history. I don't know your point of view. I don't know if you're a formalist or an advocate of absurdism, PhD in Jacobian tragedy, political theater, correct? I don't know if you'd rather see Beckett or Wasserstein and why, and that means that I have no idea how to place your opinion next to mine in a productive way. So neither do novice theatergoers giving our art form a try, and they're the ones I really care about. They could take your word for it, sure. You write for fancy papers and blogs, awesome. But no one just takes someone's word for it these days, certainly not young people. Who are you, and why do you think the way you do? What are your patterns, your interests, the last five plays you adored, the last five you hated? That's data, that's context, and that's really helpful. So with every review, or at least putting this online, because I know space is limited in papers, why not tell us, remind us who you are, why you love theater, and I know you do, why you, what you look for in a play. There's really no such thing as objectivism. So why not define your subjective for us? From lauded critic Julius Novick, to write as yourself to keep the reader aware that it's one individual writing, who may or may not be coming from where the reader's coming from, that's honesty. To own up to your subjectivity is to give the reader what she needs to truly make up his or her mind. Thank you, Julius. So there's always context. For playwrights, it is artistic intent. For critics, it's your point of view. Y'all know this, of course, but with all my reading, I'm just putting this together now. So why don't we continue to explain to all of us who we are? I'll do it too. I started keeping a Tumblr for each new play that I write as I'm writing it. Induplay.tumblr.com is one example. So it explains why I'm telling the story in this way, what sources and histories I'm tapping into, what is my artistic intent, who the hell I am, and why and how we're going about manifesting that intent. And because I will practice what I am quite literally preaching to you right now, after this weekend I'll go home and write a super clear post called Who I Am and Why I'm Writing This. Now, what would that look like for critics? Declaring intent and subjectivity. I'm sure some of you already do this, of course, but here's an example. His abiding interest in theatrical givens, like theme, story, dramatic construction, and character, could make him seem old-fashioned and set him in direct opposition to the auteur school. That was Stanley Kaufman's New York Times obituary. Another one. As a dramatic critic, he typically championed the iconoclastic and the cryptic, and he constantly dismissed the more naturalistic commercial fare found on Broadway. That's Richard Gilman's New York Times obituary. I don't think we need to wait to obituaries to declare this very informative taste our trends so that new audiences can learn which critics speak for them. So how do we serve our audiences best? We get personal. We put our tastes and our biases and our hopes for theater up front for all to see. What is your mission statement? What is your context? Knowing what you usually like helps me decide how to read your review, which is nothing but helpful, open, and encouraging to an accessible theater. Everything else is getting more and more personalized. Why not theater and its criticism? You can't write a review from everyone's perspective, but you can let them personalize based on our honesty. We personalize to the area of biases and tastes. So what if you tell each of your communities why you goddamn love theater? You don't just love it, you goddamn love it. Why? Why do you want, how do you think when you sit down and see a new play? I'd actually really love to know that. What's in your mind when the lights go down? What's the play that moved you most through all time? What made you laugh? What stuck in your brain weeks after you saw it, and why? Why do you think theater matters to America today? We know it does. Why? Not only would that catalyze an interest in theater, I think it would reintroduce your perspective to new audiences. Why should new and potential theatergoers trust your review? Where does your taste come from? Does it match theirs? They don't know. The new American is tailored to and is used to on-demand entertainment that is curated just for them. I'm not saying that's a good thing. I'm saying that's the way it is. So, how do we make that happen for theater criticism? So the selfish part on behalf of playwrights is the option for theater voters to read a review, not as a fact, but as a personal opinion, which helps if it's a bad one. I don't want someone to be turned away from a play based on someone else's personal taste when that play could have changed them into a lifelong theater patron. Again, I didn't like it is different than it's not worth seeing. So how do we encourage theater goers to define their own taste, to find the critics that help them do that? That's a theater devotee in the making. And again, that's what I care about. Because the real point is not my show or your review, the next best thing out of New York. And it's not about objectivity and prominence on the critic's voice, or whether you read reviews or don't if you're a playwright. It's of course about theater as a whole. And I think we need more cheerleaders. Who doesn't need more cheerleaders? Loud and proud. An example I like is Howard Sherman, who writes about great theater from Community all the way up. Or of course, HowlRound. Hello, HowlRound. But is there something that we can get to people who aren't already theater fans? How can we even more omni-communal? So with every project or play we do, we are ambassadors for this art. Of course we are. We are our own advocates. And we can all make theater sound awesome, even more awesome than we actually feel it is when we're working on a deadline, or not getting paid enough, or why did we God major in this charade? How do we make theater matter to more and more Americans? I think we both have the keys for that. How do we make sure that theater occurs to them to seek out at all? That's actually a big deal, especially in my city in San Francisco. We know theater achieves different storytelling than TV and film. How do we explain that over and over and over again? We tell them how theater works for and in America. We tell them often. I know many of you already do, but in this fast-paced, retweeting, what's next world, we need to be pumping it full of further examples of theater kicking ass and changing hearts. Cats get way more attention than theater does online. So much attention. And I think, although this is debatable, theater does better work for the world than do cats. Again, everyone's a critic. Todd London's book, An Ideal Theater, as I mentioned earlier, is a real inspiration to me. Reading all of those charged up women and men who said, we can do theater differently, we can do it locally, we can have other options. So I'm one of his cohort, complete with, and this is his quote, a roaring impatience, crashing idealism, compelling fanaticism, and over-the-top belief, against all odds and reason, that theater matters and can help us change the world. We can't just be that and know it, we have to keep saying it. We have to keep projecting it. As longtime editor of The Village Voice, Ross Wetson says, I don't mean the kind of parietal, they've all worked so hard, encouragement that doesn't do anyone any good, but simply a sense of mutual commitment to enhancing the theater, a sense of alliance, however uneasy, in a common cause. Far from being incompatible with high standards, this attitude provides their very basis. Hell yes to Ross. My stint as an essayist on the Huffington Post, insert your laughter here, is as a cheerleader for theater more than a reviewer. The post I wrote called How Theater for Young People Could Save the World is not a complicated article, and it's not very long, but it ties together the way young people can practice learning and empathizing and being curious through theater, how theater can do all of that with craft and wit and activism. It's a big high five to Theater for Young People, which I really do believe in, and it has encouraged parents to take their kids to a new play. And not that this is the great moral beacon of our age, but that article has been liked on Facebook 47,000 times as of last week. So somebody out there wants to re-cheer our cheer if we give it to them. So I'll take articles, posters, memes, Instagram videos, anything that keeps theater in the forefront of people's minds, especially young ones. Want to do something different that might change how you think? Go see a play. Want to remember what being in the moments is like? Go see a play. Want to laugh your ass off and feel super smart? Please go see a play. We need a Theater is America campaign. Theater is life-changing. Theater is epic. Theater is you. We have to gut milk this thing. Not really. Because this isn't about sleek ads, of course. This is about our honesty, what we know theater can be. And theater needs to be reintroduced as a force for human connection, for artistic innovation, for mind-bending ideas, empathy, intellectual revolution, boutique community building, and life affirmation. We have to think global, but you gotta see a play local. So now my colleagues need to hold up our end of the promise and create some really amazing theater. But knowing the writers working today that are at Humana this weekend included, I can promise you that we will. But y'all are on the front lines of this reintroduction. Your ilk, your papers, your blogs, your reputations, your outlets can do a lot more than a playhouse or a playwright can for speaking on behalf of theater. So we're all creating the culture that we want, and we're also allowing the culture in that we don't if we don't do anything. We're creating how theater lives in a modern society. We're offering that tone of theater's success or failure as a medium of meaning. We're doing that together. As David Bohm says, the observer and the observed affect each other. We are all of us affecting who comes to the theater, who discovers it, who comes back, who sees it as a hobby, who sees it as a profession, who comes for the first time, who thinks they aren't allowed in, who doesn't understand what to do, and who doesn't feel they have the context to feel welcome. I want theater to do work in America, not just entertain it. I want it to thrive and provoke and challenge and inspire and bring together and revel and participate in the issues of the time, not just reflect them. And yes, it's about excellence. Of course it is. But we have to move past the idea that that word isn't inherently relative and can be confined to two or three opinions of it. If we don't admit this, we are relegating our collective field to the further echelon of elitist cultural esotericism, which is not the way to welcome in a new and diverse audience. This does not mean lowering our standards or a rogue and peasant populism, but excellence cannot be one thing, and as I've mentioned before, we've got to ignore those biases. We are all responsible for the vitality and excellences of American theater. We are all responsible for making sure a new audience can find what's going to change them into theater goers. We are all responsible for making the theater occur to people that's never occurred to before. We're responsible for helping people find plays that fit them and not just satisfy us. We're responsible for the fact that female characters are fewer than male characters on most seasons, not to mention female writers and directors. We are all connected to the lack of diversity on stage, behind stage, in the audience, and in our cohort of critics. We are all connected to those things that theater needs to be doing better. We're in the arts, for God's sake. We're making this up. Because if it's all failing us, if it doesn't. So there is, yes, a simple way to do our work together. And it's the way we've always done it. But as I tell my playwright students, and I just mentioned, this is fiction. We're making this crap up. We can make it up differently. So as I said in the beginning, ours is not an antagonistic relationship. Ours is also not an esoteric, private, dramaturgical conversation. We are together and we are in public. And that public co-presence is responsible for a public coherence for theater. So, thank you for trusting me to talk to you in all honesty and community. And may we all advocate for an excellent, an open, and urgently valuable theater. Maybe also ask what we can do that we're not already doing. So I think it's worth closing this speech with a point of our community, because we are all, in fact, writers and thus share the grand presumption that anyone should give a crap about what we think anyway. We are all bonded in that. So thank you again, and I hope we meet as friends, theater ecologists, and compatriots in the future. And I really do sincerely look forward to hearing what you have to say now and next. Thank you.
It was a play at Actors Express that was written by Tina Howe. And
I was like, oh, Tina Howe's still alive, very alive, and she keeps writing plays. This is a great idea. So I kind of clicked in that and thought, I would like to be the person who defines who the hero is and what the point is and what the ending is, and that seemed like the playwright's job as opposed to the actor. So I switched to an actor.
So besides the like Yelp style thumbs up, thumbs down, liked it, hated it kind of review, what are some other things that critics write in reviews that you feel are counterproductive to playwrights?
Yeah, I mean, again, it's the idea of being misunderstood as opposed to being disliked. You can absolutely dislike what I do. You didn't enjoy the play, you didn't think it was funny, but that's different than feeling. The most frustrating reviews are the ones where I look at, what play did this person see? Because that's definitely not the one that I wrote. It's like if the play, the reviewer thinks it's a love story and I didn't write a love story, it's probably going to be a crappy love story. And that's just the way it's going to go. And that really doesn't serve either of us. So I'm really interested, and this may be a little edgy for y'all, but or for me, or for, I don't know. What I'm really interested in, I didn't quite have a way to articulate it in the speechifying I just did, but how do we, without poisoning your what objectivity you know you come into the theater with and letting the play do the work on its own, how do we incorporate the spirit of what the playwright intended? How do we, and this is part of why I started doing the Tumblr, so I can articulate it really clearly. Here's what we're going for. Here's the point of this play. It is a love story, it isn't. It's a combination, it's intending to do this. It's supposed to be funny but really dark because that's how I think we can get to the heart of real issues or whatever it is. Allowing the theater makers to kind of have their say should put the whole thing in context. So there was a great article in the American Theater Reader that came out a couple years ago. I can't remember who wrote it, but it was about context and how a group of Westchester socialites, two groups, one was taken to see a Worcester group show without any context, and they hated it and wanted to leave and felt totally abandoned by theater. And then one with context, and they loved it and couldn't stop talking about how interesting it was and compelling how they did this and that, and oh, I get it, it's about this and that. And I think that's actually really part of what I mean, that I don't exactly know how to do, but I think it makes all the world of a difference to be able to say, here's how to watch this play, not just here's what the play is or if you should go. But here's how to let it do its work best on you.
Thank you, Lauren, for such a thoughtful speech. I hope you get a copy of it because it's full of ideas. I have two questions for you. Mm-hmm. Your Worcester group example notwithstanding, can you elaborate on why you feel a need to blog your intent when your intent traditionally should be on stage in front of us? And my second question is, you told us a lot about what you don't want to see in reviews. Yeah. It would be really helpful to know what you look for in a review.
Yeah, those are great, thanks. The first one is, again, all about a context. There's always context in a play. And yes, the play, you can come in, and some are really easy to just sit down, watch, and go. But I think some of the more complex stuff, why not have an introduction to it? You know, I think that helps the play do more and new things if we don't have to spend, you know, the time kind of introducing it. I mean, yes, there is absolutely room and need for that kind of exposition, but sometimes, I mean, I use an example of like a Turelov and McCraney play. I think it's really interesting to know why he writes stage directions that way, why the language is so poetic and energetic. I want to hear why, so that when I go see it, I can go, oh, it is poetic and energetic. Look at that. That's great. As opposed to, why are they talking in verse, or why are they saying their stage directions, or why are they doing, you know, whatever playwrights are inventing new ways to do. So for INU, it was one of the interesting things that we found initially was there was some hesitation to a play about teenagers that wasn't a play for teenagers. And being able to say, the intention is, for my intention for that play was, we never leave high school, really. So the selves that we are at that age are our nascent selves, but are our true selves, too. And looking at all of humanity through the lens of teenagers lets us go back into that kind of safe, womb-like space of a teenager's bedroom, but really explore all the things that will become from those kids. I think that's important to know, that I don't want the characters to say on stage. You know what I mean? My mom says I was going to be a teenager. Like, no. I want to be able to have that in the air, but without having to say it. And the other question was, what to see in reviews. I would love for that to be a part of it, to kind of even look at and some playwrights don't want to share an artistic intent. They don't want anything to do with what I'm talking about, and that's, of course, completely valid. But some of us take a lot of time figuring out, not that the other ones don't, but articulating why I wrote it this way. And I think sharing that next to a review might be a really interesting way to attempt that conversational criticism. The artistic intent here, the review here, so they can bounce off of each other. It might be an interesting idea. What else? Again, I love I hate musicals. This isn't me, this is a fictional person. I actually like musicals. I usually don't like classic musicals. That's my bias. But in the review, I actually really love this production of Carousel. You know what I mean? That would actually air the bias. And if you hated the production of Carousel, the poor writer can be, or not the writer, but the actors can go, well, you didn't like musicals anyway. Or if you did like it, it's an even better review to go, I hate musicals and I love this musical. So there's something about the honesty of that I think will serve, again, not entirely to protect artists from reviews. That's not what I'm intending, and it's always going to sound like that since I am one. But I think that's part of it. That may be the beginning of that conversation. I may have to think some more, but we'll continue having it.
You said that you were commissioned to write a play about a person.
Mm-hmm.
That makes you kind of a theater critic in a sense, because you have to decide what's going to go on stage. And let's say the Republican National Committee asked you to write a play about Hillary Clinton. What would you do?
I would not take that commission. I would take it and I would write my play about Hillary Clinton. And they would probably hate it, and then the Democrats would produce it. Yeah.
You celebrate the person. I mean, you have this.
Yeah. No, it's a more complicated question. Yeah. You know, that play, it's all about finding the humanity that everyone has, even in the hardest characters. So what was interesting about this character is his name is Rudolf Bauer. He's a real person, an artist, and part why it's interesting is he's a prickly guy, and he was not liked in the New York art world for a long time. And that's part of why we don't know his name, because he was kind of erased from the history books by powerful people. But that's what the play's about. So how do I show this cranky guy that I don't want to have a dinner party with, but I'm writing about? I have to find his humanity in his heart. So it took some interesting research and some real aha moments of saying, oh, there you are. That's the soft guy that still has some hope. I don't know if that exactly answers your question, but it's always, for me, finding that humanity. That's the soft person inside the exterior.
Thank you. It's very interesting to hear you refer to us as theater ecologists and cheerleaders, because I think there's not one person in this room who isn't a cheerleader, or who doesn't want to maintain theater as it is, perhaps to continue in some other vein than it has been, but to make sure that it exists for all of our future progeny. I wonder, it's sort of like our relationship, as you mentioned, is not antagonistic. But we do have the inevitable position of having to come to a feast being prepared by a chef who's constantly changing the recipe. And I wondered, there's a point at which you have to let it go. You have to say, this is our baby, and here it is, where you have to say to yourself, this is the finished product. Even though some people like Tennessee Williams might have rewritten the play he'd written 20 years before as the way he would have had. Can you tell us a little bit about that and how we can help you do a better job in manufacturing these plays?
Yeah, the chef metaphor was lovely, by the way. Thank you for that. I think part of what I was excited about explaining in this speech and now is that sense of, it's because it's always changing, because playwrights aren't done, and literally everyone I talked to said it's two or three times before you get that right, when even with raves. Just being aware of the fact that the plays are still in progress, and being, the only thing I care about in terms of bad reviews is bad reviews of brand new plays, because those are the ones that can really behead a play before it has a chance to even grow up. And so that's what I really care about. There's a lot of plays, some even at this weekends like this in the past here at Humana, have just gotten slammed and are never seen from again. And not only does that take away a play, but it just, it didn't have to be taken away. Who knows what they learned from this production that you move on. So I think having a little bit, and again, it's hard to not sound like I'm saying use kid gloves and be super nice to new plays, but there's something with the awareness of where is this play going next? How is it, it has potential. What is the potential in it? That may be a better version of here's what I didn't like about that new play, but the potential I saw in it is this and this, even if it may have not delivered in this way or that way. I think that allows the writer to escape the guillotine for the moment of some French Revolution references I keep dropping. Sorry. I'm writing a play about it right now, so that's all prayer. Again, just that awareness of the process a new play takes, and because we all love theater and can't wait for that next new play that's going to be the thing we keep reading about for years and years and years, that's part of it, is being understanding. And again, that's the hardest thing for players, is not having that understanding. And
I hear you, it sounds to me like you're making a distinction between a review and a critique. I consider a review, I saw this play, I didn't like it. End of story. As opposed to, I saw this play, I didn't like it for this reason, for that reason. This worked, that didn't work. If you look at that piece over there, that's the way it was done there that worked better than it worked here.
Yeah.
And I'm wondering if that's really the distinction. You keep referring to review, review, mm-hmm. review. But are you really saying review versus critique?
Yeah, probably. You would know better than I. But I do know that when people read them, they're probably the same thing. They're trying to figure out which show to go to. And especially new audience members are going to say, I mean, it's like me with ballet. I don't know. You tell me what's good. I haven't been, but I don't have my own taste yet. So I think part of that distinction is moot on a certain theater goer and some who, again, I think this is where having people find the critics who speak their language. I trust your reviews. I want to know everything that you like because we seem to like the same things over and over again. I go to a play that you like and I'm great. Okay, I can trust you. But it's the kind of, again, I'm just trying to, and there's a difference between it is bad. Yes, there are plays that are just bad, and the acting is bad, and the directing is boring, yes, okay. But again, I think that's different than I really didn't get it or like it or enjoy it, and no one will get this or like this or enjoy it. And I think that's what is harmful to new plays, to new audiences. All the news, I think, start losing, they start slipping when that happens, because we really want plays to do the speaking. As wonderful speakers as y'all are and cheerleaders for American theater, you know, we want to have people go to the theater and want to come back because they know how to find the plays that they like.
Yeah, I think I'd like to hear your comment about a problem you've given us on the very things you're talking about. Your beautiful play, I Am You, has a surprise ending, which we don't dare say anything about except it's a surprise ending because no one wants to ruin it.
Thank you for that, by the way.
But just before end of play, you put in the playwright's note on how you feel about it and what has happened, which I think is lovelier and more poetic and more informative than we get in the plays, like the George Bernard Shaw's Candida is a famous last line no one ever hears, because he wrote it but no one says it. And in fact, I don't know if you're going to be at Jiva tonight where it plays next, but if you were, I was going to ask you if you would treat the opening night audience who stay to talk to you afterwards by reading them that note before answering questions, because I think it would be a special treat.
Yeah.
The question is how to deal with that when the playwright has actually put something in the script that is not in the play.
Yeah, that's an amazing question, and thank you for your support of the play and for reading that statement, which I did spend a lot of time on. My intent for that last page of the script is for every audience member to get it as they walk out. Or there's a secret special link that you can get so that it's not, you know, you don't spoil the ending. But my intent is for that to be shared as much as is possible. And we haven't found a way to do that quite yet, because it's easy to spoil it, yes, and that is an important thing to do. But
you can't put it in the program.
No, no, you can't, because people will read it and then they'll walk out because they're done with the surprise. Yeah, it's a good question, and I didn't know what other way, except for during the rehearsals for the first production, I kept getting these questions and these, you know, I would say, well, yeah, that's actually, that's why he says that there, and they go, oh, that's great. So I just kind of started making a note of it. And again, that play plays with naturalism, and then it's popped kind of towards the end, and I didn't want to mess with that. And I didn't want to make it more hyper-theatrical before it needed to be, and all of those choices. So the only way I knew was to define it at the end and kind of figure out how do we let people have that. I don't know exactly, but I know that my intention is to have it be shared in a way that people can benefit from it. And I hope it, you may want to come see it again after you read it, just to see kind of in that icy dead people way that you're like, ooh, it matched up, it worked. Or if there is, you know, another way to continue that conversation, so you continue to think about the play after it happens. So yeah.
I'm interested in the relationships between yourself as an artist and the critics who cover you. During a lecture by Frank Rich, he talked about the fact that he didn't know anyone in the theater world, that he only wanted to go to the show, see what was on stage, form a judgment of that experience. He had one exception, Stephen Sondheim, which was remarkable. I feel very strongly that the artist is the primary source. You know, I want the information from the artist. So in my case, that entails often reading early drafts of plays, going to rehearsals, having dialogues with the playwright, with the actors, seeing something in development. Of course, it gets very tough on opening night because how do you recuse yourself from all that information? So could you kind of comment on that process? We have two points of view.
Yeah.
That you don't know the critic, the critic doesn't know you, and that's the way it should be ethically. Mm-hmm. And then there's another point of view that you know, you're the source, and that dialogue may or may not be productive to you.
I am super in the second camp. I think theater is an ethically ambiguous art form. No, I actually think what you're talking about, going to development, being in conversation, I think that's incredible. And I wish more critics felt comfortable doing that. I understand that you want to have an objectivity when you sit down, but as I mentioned, like, where is that really? You're not objective, of course you're not. You know the theater, you've seen other plays by this writer, you've seen that actor do this and that, what you had for, you know, brunch that day is affecting the opinion. I'm not, you know, exactly meaning that, but. So I think that there's something that, and I don't know why you would have to recuse yourself from it. Again, I'm not a critic, and it's totally obvious, I'm sure, by now, but I think that being able to say, I saw this in development, and here's what's changed. I know what the conversations were. I bet audiences would love that. In fact, every talkback that I ever do, that's the questions from the audience immediately. How did you write it? What were the changes? What was the last thing you did? That's the stuff they want to know. So, I mean, that may be a place to start, and another further example of, I mean, I love that. I know it's hard. I know it takes a lot more time than a lot of us have than to go and really read all those drafts and do that good work you're doing, but God, that sounds amazing.
I'd also like to add that the big question when you start that kind of relationship, an ongoing relationship with a particular actor, particular director, a particular playwright, I think the primary question and issue becomes trust.
Yes, indeed.
I mean, there has to, you know, and oftentimes it's very difficult to earn on both sides. I mean, what is the intention? Why are we doing this? What is the end result?
I think that's why it doesn't happen very much. But that's conversational criticism to me. You are actually in dialogue with the entire process, and I think sharing it, again, people want to see that. They want to know. Every talkback has that same question, so that maybe you may be onto something there. That's part of what I'm interested in, some of the relationships I have with critics in the Bay. Chad Jones is a great blogger for Theater Dogs, and he just gets my work, and it's a way that we can really talk about how this play is conversing with this play, and it's a really wonderful thing. And it's not to say that he likes everything that I do, it's in different degrees, but he always gets it. So I trust him, I feel safe. Yeah.
Lauren, thanks for the great talk. You mentioned how easy it is for new plays to have their heads cut off or whatever body part you mentioned. And I wonder what responsibility you think theaters have in this. You mentioned the National New Play Network, which is trying to avoid the problem of the world premiere-itis, thing. And theaters, I'm going to a world premiere next week, they put so much emphasis on the debut, but the idea, I think, in my head has always been, and I think a lot of audience members, is that a world premiere is, there, here's the new next big thing.
Yeah.
And never, until the last couple of years, thought of it as the first step.
Yeah.
And so I wonder if you could talk a little bit about that part of the theaters.
Yeah, that's a great point. I actually hadn't thought about that before. But of course, there's responsibility in this, you know, here it comes, the big thing. And of course, there's various degrees in which it is ready to be the big thing. But I mean, I don't know exactly. I know they're doing that for marketing reasons and audience development and things that, you know, we don't concern ourselves with. But of course we do. So I don't know. I mean, maybe it's educating an audience to understand what a new play really is and that it's, I mean, I think a lot of them do. I know incredible boards who are more excited to that it is in progress than that it is done. I don't know. I think that's a great conversation to have, and maybe it's a great article that I hope someone writes, perhaps you can, about that, because it's true. Getting over the world premiere-itis is one of the big things National New Play Network does, but Jason Lowith, who was the artistic director of ONLY and used to be the artistic director of the National New Play Network, he's a big proponent, not just of the National New Play Network as a way of, but the rolling premieres as like, here's the play, you just hand it off, but that you're working on it. You're in conversations with those theaters, which certainly is the case for IMU. We did a lot of work, and a lot of great ideas and conversations came out of that that makes the play what it is. So, thanks. That's a great question.
Hi. You spoke about helping an audience find a critic that speaks to them, and I think that's great in markets where there are multiple critics. Part of the problem we're seeing around the country is the shrinking number of markets that allow for reviews. Up in Indianapolis, where IMU is at the Phoenix Theater, at best you might get a one paragraph plus stars review from the All Weekly. There's no critic at all at the newspaper of record, and I was out of town last week. So, the chance of getting up, I'm wondering, as a playwright, are there benefits to not being reviewed at all, or barely being reviewed? And in an ideal world, at this stage of the process, would you honestly prefer that nobody write about it? Forget the marketing side, just as a playwright.
No, at this stage in the process, review it. I feel great about it now. We did all the hard stuff. Feel good, enjoy it or not, I'm done, it's great. It's that first one. And I know that must be so hard to have, to not have anybody speaking on behalf of theater, and I think that's its own issue and problem that I don't know how to deal with, except for encouraging another generation of reviewers. And it's gonna be online, it always is. That's what's shared on Facebook and tweeted, and those are the reviews that get the most reads, because I think people are like, read it, it tells us we're good. As opposed to the bad ones, which everyone's like, don't post it, don't even read it, don't read it. So I don't know, but yeah, I'm a fan of reviews once it's the play that we want it to be and I feel good about it, then yeah, let's have that conversation, but yeah.
Yes, so following on his question, do you give any more credence to a reviewer, a critic who has been writing for a number of years, as opposed to a first-time blogger or someone who you've never heard of before? You've referenced a lot today about reading the good reviews versus the bad reviews, and it seems to me that you're a playwright. We aren't to tell you how to write your play, so why would you want to get information from us about how to do your job? And so if you're looking only for praise, then following on his comment, maybe we don't serve a purpose other than it is a point of record to talk about the kinds of theater that new playwrights are presenting and telling us what is going on in our society because of what you're writing. But I'm wondering, do you only want to read anybody, or do you want to read people that you think have some knowledge about theater?
I will read anyone, but I usually don't. I think the misconception is that I don't actually want to read good reviews either. I feel more safe doing that, and my agent likes it to pull out quotes and things to help the play's life. It's a complicated thing, and I think every playwright deals with reviews in a different way. My great colleague Steve Yockey's like, bring them all on, I want to read everything, and I'm like, can't do it, nope. a complicated question. Of course you serve a purpose, of course, absolutely. And I would never say that the world would be better without this kind of conversation. It's just a different thing for the playwright than for the audience, I think, to read. And the perspective of how I interpret a review has to go through all the many filters, including my husband, to figure out if that's something I need in my mind. Because again, if I don't know your voice, which is part of my main point, I would love to have another person who can speak intelligibly about the history of my work and I know where they're coming from. It's like in every review, whether it's from an artistic director or an audience member, there's some truth behind it. It doesn't mean that you tell me you should change this line or the title's weird or something like that, but it means that there's a point there. But it's my job to figure out how to use it or not, or how to go with it. But y'all's job is so hard. I don't know how you do it. I'm not sure exactly how to answer that completely, but it's kind of a good question.
Let me ask you two questions, if I may. The first is, do you suppose your objective of discovering the reviewer's biases is realized by an audience member after about a dozen reviews anyway? I mean, is it really necessary for me to write down all the things that I hate when my readers already know it?
Yeah, I think your readers definitely know it, but a new person who's just looking at some review, they're not going to go read everything you've written and compare it to the play, because that would take a knowledge of American theater, what the plays were about, you know what I mean? So I think it's something of declaring it makes it easier for people who, you know, have never been to a play or are really excited about it or have been to a lot to be able to go,
Would I have to declare it to the same degree of complexity as those obituaries that you read? Would the reader understand those things?
Maybe. I mean, I don't know exactly. I mean, I think, and some of us, it's always hard to see our own trends. So I'm sure that, you know, there's reviewers that I've read that I go, he hates anything emotional with an emotional ending. He always does. Every play that has a big squishy ending, he thinks it sucks. So I know that. He may not know that. But a lot of the colleagues do. So it may be something of however you can self-diagnose, looking at self-diagnose. Sounds like you're all ill. But just the idea of looking at what you like and kind of maybe orienting in your way to declare it yourself as opposed to having to read all the reviews, which a lot of young people are not going to go do that.
All right, let me ask you one other question then. If you consider the critic, the playwright to have a dialogue, is there not value in finding out whether somebody has misunderstood your play or lost your context and being able to assess why that happened? It might be that the critic's a moron, but at least you know that you've lost the moron audience.
Which is great. Lost the moron audience. Awesome. This is part of where it's complex, because it is actually really helpful for somebody to say, that's awesome, but I didn't get that from what I saw. That's always helpful. But it's also, I think the role of the critic is to help an audience figure out how to see that show, because I can't change the show at that by the time you review it. But we can, especially in new plays. Again, this is not all the plays and all the revivals, but it's the new, brand new baby world premiere plays that may need your help. And there's a great help to be able to say, when I first saw it, I didn't understand this, but if you think about it as a metaphor of blah, 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 then you'll probably really have a great time. But that's what I missed on the first time. Like, that's super helpful, and also does the job of informing the playwright, but also informing the audience so that production isn't lost. Else. I know we're super late, so.
In the interest of time, I need to ask you all to thank Lauren Gunderson.
I know that several of you still have some additional questions, and Lauren will be around for the next few days. I urge you to make her acquaintance. Buy her a meal, take her out for a drink, whatever, and continue the conversation. We have to move, and we're due to start our panel on social media at 3:30 in one of the rehearsal rooms, and I'm going to ask Kirsty Galpo to help give us directions to that. I know she's given some of you those directions, but I don't have them, so I need to ask her.
Oh, sure. So when you exit,